como otra vez en la
today, the seminar will be presented by Manel Martinez from IFAI in Barcelona. He will talk about the Cherenkov Telescope Observatory. And as this is the first colloquium by the Severo Ochoa, the first Severo Ochoa seminar, the speaker will be introduced by the director of the Severo Ochoa, Isabel.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the inauguration, official inauguration of this Severo Ochoa IAA colloquia. As you know, we proposed in our project to invite internationally highly renowned scientists. So we have the first example of such scientists here with us, Manel Martinez. I have just a one-page kind of abstract of his all the facts describing his career. This is really impressive. I have not time to tell everything about this excellent researcher. We have to congratulate our own country for having such kind of profiles in Spain. And just to give you some numbers on some of the works in which he has been collaborating and collaborates still. He has published more than 600 papers. And he has given more than 150 talks, more than 50 invited plenary talks. He has advised 13 PhD theses, 6 masters, and a number of engineers' works as well. He's expert in high energy physics and astroparticle physics, and he has been leading MAGIC, and now CTA in Spain. He's expert of the commission of the sorry, because I have just changed my glasses yesterday, so I have a problem with focusing everything. He's expert of the commission of infrastructures of the FBE program in Spain, and he's the director, so it's a colleague in that sense, of his Severo Ochoa program in the IFAI. He's the chair of the MAGIC, has been chair of the MAGIC collaboration board. And actually, now he's the chair of the steering committee of the CTA Large Site Telescope, LST, among many others that I have in this paper here. So it's really impressive. We are very grateful for having you here. Today he's going to talk about the Cherenkov Telescope Observatory for very high energy gamma ray astronomy in this new area for us, astronomers of multimessenger. I think it's quite interesting for us to have such a possibility of studying the universe with a multi-messenger. And he's going to talk about this project and in particular about the crucial role of the Spanish community in this project. So thanks for coming, and thanks, Manel, for giving us your talk.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction, and thank you all for giving me the opportunity and the honor to be the first speaker of this series of colloquium that I'm absolutely convinced that is going to be a great success. So I want to introduce to some of you what is the Cherenkov Telescope Array. And for those of you that already know what is it, I'll try to explain you what is the situation nowadays, and as was already explained, how the Spanish community is involved, and how you, any member of the scientific community in Spain and other countries, would be able to use this infrastructure, because this is going to be an observatory, an open observatory. So this is basically the outline that I'm going to present in the next slide, but let me just explain what this picture is. This shows the first CTA telescope already in the Roque de los Muchachos Observatory in a starry night, ready to start observing the sky in order to look for the things that I'm going to explain in few slides from now. As you see, there is another telescope in the background which is already focused to the sky. That's Magic 2 telescope, and that's because LST, that's the name of this telescope, as I will explain, is already going to operate with two additional telescopes that are going there, and in few months from now will be the most powerful Cherenkov observatory on the Earth at this moment. I will explain that in few slides. So the outline of my presentation is the following. First, I will explain you the make of the CTA project. That is going to be the longest part of my talk. It should take something like 30 minutes, so be patient. Then I will tell you what the role of CTA Spain is and should be in the future. And CTA Spain includes a group in this institute led by Ivan, and I'm proud to be in an institute that is already contributing to this effort in the way it is done. Then I will explain you what CTA will do as an observatory and how will you be able to contribute to the possible success of all this project. And then I will give a summary and an outline. Just in case you get bored or sleepy, let me start from the end, so I'm then sure that you get the message back home of what I want to explain. Well, as I will explain you, the initial idea of this project came already many years ago. This was 2006. And since then, it has managed to get in the most important roadmaps all over the world. European forums like ESFRI, Aspera, Astronet, and also in American reviews, PASAC, Decadal Review. And that is one of the reasons why the project has been progressing. This is an expensive project, but it was recognized already, thanks to the effort at the beginning, that is worth. And I'll try to convince you that this is the case. I will also try to convince you, and that should be the conclusion after my slides, that since its conception, CTA Spain has played and shall keep playing a leading role in the project. We were there already in 2006. I was co-leading the whole effort together with Professor Bernard Hoffman in Heidelberg. And since then, the Spaniards have played a key role in this project, as I will explain. And what is the next message I want you to take back home? That after 12 years of effort, since 2016, CTA now is completing a pre-construction phase. It has passed a critical design review. I will explain what is all that. It has already a north and south site selected. It has already headquarters and a science data management center. It has working prototypes of all the telescopes that should constitute the observatories. And now is heading towards the construction phase with that telescope that I shown you in the previous slide. So de facto, CTA has started construction and is being built already now. Then the last point that I will try to convince you in my slides is that CTA shall be soon the first ground-based open observatory in the field of astroparticle physics. So far, in the field of astroparticle physics, no open observatory existed. CTA will be the first. And it should provide a new leap in our explanation of the high-energy universe. So, final message, CTA is finally coming on the stage. Okay, so let me start with the first part, the make of the CTA project. Those of you that are already familiar with gamma ray astronomy probably can now put yourself in a standby mode because I'm going to explain very basic things. But those of you that do not have a clear picture on what a Cherenkov telescope is, please be attentive because what I will explain now explains the rest of the things that you are going to listen. Well, as astrophysicists, all of you know very well that if you place a telescope in the ground, the atmosphere is opaque to basically all the wavelengths of the electromagnetic radiation, except for some small windows in which the astronomy and astrophysics has developed naturally since many centuries ago. That's what you see in this plot. You see here, energy increases in this direction, wavelength increases in this direction. Those are gammas of the highest energies. Here you have radio waves of the lowest energies. And just in radio, in some windows in radio, and in the optical, our atmosphere is transparent. That means that if you want to explore the universe at the highest energies, in principle, it is non-trivial to do it. First, because for an obvious reason, when you go to higher energies, sources that are able to produce electromagnetic radiation produce less quantity of electromagnetic radiation. So the flux decreases as power lows. Therefore, the obvious solution for the wavelengths in which you cannot place telescopes in the ground is sending satellites. But satellites, when you go to very high energy, are very inefficient because the fluxes are so low that you don't catch events. So you have to try to find another solution. And that's what basically people realized about 30 years ago when this technique started development. So, as I said, one solution is putting particle detector, a gamma ray detector, in a satellite, and that's the case of Fermi, but you are restricted to areas which are at the level of 1 square meter, which is the effective area of Fermi, roughly. And with 1 square meter for very high energies, you don't have flux, so it's very boring. What happens in the ground for energies larger than this range? Well, what happens is that gammas do not disappear. They are stopped by the atmosphere, but of course, stop means that those gammas initiate nuclear reactions and produce electromagnetic showers. So showers of ultra-relativistic particles, which in a kind of fractal development are able to to take all the energy of the gamma and distribute it in particles which finally may reach the ground. And at the same time, those particles may produce an additional effect that I'm going to explain soon in another slide, which is Cherenkov light. So basically, those are the techniques that you may try to use, and they are related to the energy range of the gamma rays that you pretend to explore. If your target is reaching up to, say, 10 GeV, you put a detector in a satellite. If you want to go above these energies and reach TVs, then you use Cherenkov light, as I will explain. And if you want to go to the highest energies where the flux is very small, you may try to use particle detectors, although Cherenkov telescopes also can be used at the highest energies, as I will explain. Well, this was the concept. This concept has been explored for many years by many teams, and this is the kind of evolution that these two techniques that I was describing before have developed. And there has been a kind of Darwin selection in those techniques. Many techniques have been developed, but just few have survived the test of time and are the ones that nowadays are used for the current generation of gamma ray observatories and for the future generation. The one that I will describe in detail is telescope arrays, and as you see here, they may cover from, say, 5 GeV up to half teta electron ball. The limit here is just related to the flux you may reach. There is no instrumental limit. You also have, as an alternative technique, the detection of the particles in the ground using water Cherenkov detectors in the surface or scintillator arrays. Both techniques have proven to work as well, and they may be used to cover this range of energy above, say, half a TeV. Then, let me explain, for those of you that do not know this Cherenkov telescope technique, how does it work? Well, you have a gamma ray impinging in the atmosphere. In the upper layers of the atmosphere, it finds a nucleus and collides with this nucleus and produces a particle shower. Those particles are so energetic that they travel faster than light on the air. And that produces a radiation related to something that goes faster than the speed of light in the medium. And this is called Cherenkov light. Cherenkov light is an emission which is peaked in the ultraviolet, but since it has to cross the atmosphere, it is filtered out in such a way that at the end, on ground, you get a kind of bluish light. So the characteristics is that you get a bluish light. The opening angle for Cherenkov light for the ultra-relativistic particles we are talking about is around 1 degree. That means that you get an area which is between 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 5 square meters illuminated. And another important thing is that this is a flash of light extremely fast. It's typically 1 nanosecond duration. So how can you detect this light? Well, you have to place a telescope in this, what we call the light pool. The telescope has to have the largest possible reflector area, has to be sensitive to the blue radiation, so it's an optical telescope, and has to have a camera that is sensitive in time scales of 1 nanosecond, so does not integrate like a CCD in optical astronomy, but just does the opposite, differentiates, tries to find fast variations. Okay, as you can see, if you place just one telescope in this light pool, you can detect the particle. That means that the effective area does not depend on the telescope size. It is fixed by the characteristics of the Cherenkov radiation, and as I said, it's 10 to the 4 to 10 to the 5 square meters, obviously much, much larger, 5 orders of magnitude larger than the one you can get in a satellite like Fermi. So that's what makes this technique advantageous with respect to a satellite. You cannot place a satellite with this area. We don't know how to do it. That's simply the case. Then, if you see in this picture, I don't have one telescope, I have few telescopes. Well, the idea is the following. Every telescope will see the development of this Cherenkov light like a kind of cigar, pointed to the axis of the telescope, if the axis of the telescope is directed towards the direction of the gamma ray. That means that if you place few telescopes there, you will have few cigars in which, if you compose the image, they should converge at the center. That's the way you identify that this was a gamma ray. And furthermore, from this image, you get information on the energy of the gamma that was impinging here and the actual direction, and you improve this information by having multiple images of the same shower. That's why you need arrays. Okay. This was all about the techniques. This is the TV observatories nowadays in operation. There are three observatories of Cherenkov telescopes, Veritas in Arizona, the MAGIC telescopes in La Palma, the Hess telescopes in Namibia, and two successful arrays of particles detecting particles in the ground. That's HOC in Mexico, so the Northern Hemisphere, and Tibet, Argo, also in the Northern Hemisphere, in Tibet, of course. So I mentioned that with Cherenkov telescopes, you can cover the whole spectrum, but I also said that these particle arrays are used and are useful, and there are even projects for the future, now in construction in China, very, very large ones. What is the pros and the cons of each one of these techniques? Well, Cherenkov telescopes have as cons the fact that they have low uptime because they detect light, so they have to operate in the night and with clear skies. Yeah, they have a small field of views because they are pointing telescopes, and then you see the sky where you point, not the whole sky. But as an advantage, they have excellent background rejection, angular resolution, energy resolution, so you can really do detailed studies of the sources that are producing the gammas. Therefore, they are useful for deep surveys to analyze point sources to have high resolution energy spectra. Particle detector arrays, on the contrary, have high uptime because, well, they are just detecting particles in an enclosed detector. They operate day and night, 24/7. They have large field of view because they are not directional. Well, they have some directionality, but certainly they can cover almost 2 pi. And they have reasonable background rejection and angular resolution, not as good by far as the one of Cherenkov Telescope Arrays. So you can use these kind of things, complementing what Cherenkov telescopes do for unbiased surveys, for transients, for extended or diffuse emission, and for cosmic rays and solar physics. Anyway, to be honest, the winner in this competition are the Cherenkov Telescope Arrays. If you compare the scientific outcome of these arrays, has nothing to do with the outcomes of the arrays of particles detectors that I was showing. And those are the three arrays that are currently in operation. In Namibia, you have HES, which is for telescopes of 12 meter diameters plus a monster of 28 meters diameter in the middle. That's the largest Cherenkov telescope ever built, probably the largest optical reflector ever built. I think it's in the Guinness book, actually. Here you have the MAGIC telescopes in La Palma, two 17-meter telescopes. Those ones started operation in 2003. MAGIC started operation in 2004. And here you have the four 12-meter Veritas telescopes in Arizona. Those are four 12-meter telescopes and started a little bit later. So lost a little bit the competition on the first hot results in the field. In this sense, Europe has been really leading the whole effort in Cherenkov astronomy, although the origins of this technique came from the Whipple telescope in Arizona as well. So the Americans started, but we took over, and now we are leading the field. Okay, what can you do with those telescopes? Well, so far, with those telescopes that I was showing you, we detected something like 175 sources. I will come later to the kind of sources that we observe and what do you learn from them. But here you see, you have active galactic nuclei, you have galactic sources which are pleiadians or supernova remnants or binaries. Well, there is a long list of beasts that you can study with these kind of telescopes. By the way, there is a new source which was not here. We discovered it with the MAGIC telescope just about 1 month and a half ago. We detected a gamma ray burst that was not observed in this energy range ever before. And that's a very interesting result, as it will be seen soon. We'll publish soon something. Anyway, let me tell you something which may be relevant. Those of you that are familiar also with Fermi and have used the Fermi catalogs for your studies will say, okay, here you have 175 sources, whereas in the Fermi catalogs you have a few thousand sources. So, yes, clearly the amount of sources we have collected so far is not impressive, but the kind of things you can do with these sources, the kind of understanding that you can get, has been worth many articles of very high impact about microquasars, about pulsars, about supernova remnants, about the galactic center, the Magellanic Cloud surveys, about the starburst, AGNs, the extragalactic background light, dark matter, Lorentz invariance violation constraints, cosmic ray electrons, or even from past year, some relation with cosmic neutrinos, so a step in the direction of multimessenger. So there is an important scientific harvest that you could get already from this generation of telescopes. Then, what is CTA? I have been explaining the present situation, somehow the past and the present. CTA is the future. And let me tell you, for me, the most important thing of CTA is the people. The people that thought that one can go one step ahead and improve this technique in such a way that you discover a new a new realm of scientific targets of interest. And the people is a collaboration, an international collaboration, where there are collaborators from all over the world, from Australia, Japan, India, the south of Africa, South America, North America, and of course Europe. In September 2018, when we had our last meeting, general meeting, we were about 1,500 people already from 31 countries and 204 institutes. And these people, already in 2006, as I explained you, was thinking, how can we improve on the current generation of Cherenkov telescopes? Certainly what we need to improve are more events and better events. More events means you detect more photons, therefore you can do better spectra, images, you can observe fainter sources, and the way you get more events is unavoidable. You need larger collection area, so you need really larger area. And in order to get better events, how do you do it? Well, you have to do more precise measurement of the atmospheric cascades and therefore of the gammas that have originated them. And I explained already that you improve your understanding of the original gamma that produced the shower by having multiple images. So here you see the superposition of what would be the situation if you would have 8 cameras detecting the same gamma ray. Well, that's not showing the quantitative effect, but allows you to understand that you get a lot of redundancy and therefore a big improvement in your understanding of the gamma. So it's unavoidable. You need to put more telescopes. And you need to put more telescopes in a way in which you benefit completely from having more telescopes. MAGIC is 2 telescopes. And if you want to use them in stereo, so in such a way that they both get image of the gamma ray that has impinged the atmosphere at once, so you can improve your understanding at the level of resolution in energy and angle of the gammas, there is just an area in which you get this information. This is what we call the sweet spot. Yeah? And this is a small area. If you would be able to get a large array of telescopes covering a large patch in the ground, then the spot, the sweet area, really gets almost as large as the periphery of the telescopes. And that's the key point. You need to go to this number of telescopes where really the sweet spot is able to contain completely the light pool originated by the Cherenkov emission. So the idea is you need larger detection area, more images per shower, better gamma resolution, and lower energy threshold. And well, after all that, obviously, the answer is you need to build something like that. So the answer to what is CTA? CTA should be an advanced facility for very high energy gamma ray astronomy. The goal was having at least 10-fold sensitivity and energy range with respect to the current installations, HES, MAGIC, Veritas, and improve angular and spectral resolution also by an order of magnitude. And how do you do that? Well, building many telescopes and deploying them in a large area in the ground. So it's a mixed array of Cherenkov telescopes. Actually, here you see telescopes of 3 sizes. I don't know whether you can identify them. Those are the largest telescopes, mid-sized telescopes, and a big amount of small-sized telescopes around. Each telescope has its own role in the whole thing, and is related to this sensitivity curve that you can see here. If you would build large-sized telescopes have large collection area. They are able to see lower energy gammas, because a lower energy gamma produces less light, so you need a largest telescope to collect the light. So that could be the sensitivity you would get if you would make an array with LSTs. If you would use mid-sized telescopes, that would be the sensitivity. And if you use many small-sized telescopes and distribute them in the area I was describing, then you would get that. So if you want to improve in a energy domain that is the largest possible, you need to mix up types of telescopes with the right balance. And this is basically what CTA did. I will tell you which is the balance in a few slides from now. Okay, so this was the first goal of the CTA collaboration, defining this kind of concept, the array of three kinds of telescopes. The second concept is that we know that the sky, with the sources that we have observed so far, is as interesting in the north as in the south, so we want all the sky coverage. And for that, the idea is building a telescope in the north, as I will tell you, the site is already decided, and is the Roque de los Muchachos Observatory, and an observatory in the south, and the site is ISO in Chile. This is the right mixture of telescopes to get the optimal sensitivity. So in the north, 4 large telescopes, 15 mid-sized telescopes, and in the south, 4 large-sized telescopes, 25 mid-sized telescopes, and 70 small-sized telescopes. This was the cost estimated a few years ago. I think this is still reasonable, 300 million euros, but this does not count for manpower. This is just material cost. So if you would use the American way of counting, this would be almost double. You may ask yourself why in the south you have small-sized telescopes and in the north you don't. The reason is that in the north you don't have direct view on the galactic center, and then the focus is extragalactic science. And extragalactic science is characterized by the fact that very high energy gamma rays do not arrive to us because they are absorbed in their way from the source to us by per production in the extragalactic background light. So it will be not useful to put here small-sized telescopes because the rate would be so lousy that it will not pay off. So this is the configuration that corresponds to the numbers I was describing. So in the south is something like this amount of telescopes distributed in this area, which is 3 kilometers times 3 kilometers, so 10 square kilometers. And in the north is much more compact. In the north is 19 telescopes, and well, they fit in a square of, say, 1 kilometer side. So this is CTA. And let me mention something which I think is relevant. I mean, putting more and more and more telescopes to improve on your observatory may look like brute force. Yeah, one may question, isn't there a clever solution than just putting a carpet of telescopes? Well, we didn't find it, but let me say that having a carpet of telescopes introduces features in the observatory that were never tested so far. For instance, if all these telescopes point to the same place, then you get the highest sensitivity. And then you can do very deep field observations of sources which are far away and have low flux. But it may happen that you want to monitor what is happening with variable sources, with transients, and at the same time, and you don't need such a high sensitivity, and at the same time you want to explore some possible candidates for dark matter annihilation. Then you may split your array in such a way that you have some telescopes monitoring sources that you want to monitor, or one third of the telescopes performing a deep field, other telescopes doing other monitoring, and so on. That's possible as observation modes, and it's new. This was not possible in the past with the amount of telescopes we had. Furthermore, you can also try to do a full sky scan just by arranging in a clever manner the fields of views of the telescopes in such a way that they have some overlap, but then they can scan a big patch of the sky and get, for instance, full sky at current sensitivity in just 1 year. That's very important because that may allow to enlarge the catalog of very high energy gamma ray sources. So, what's the status and the plans? Well, what I was explaining was the concept. We worked hard, and in June 2015, we were able to write 5,000 pages explaining how to build each one of those telescopes. We went, well, here you see all the work packages that were defined and so on. and we pass what is what was called a critical design review. The critical design review was the green light to start producing physically those telescopes and really demonstrate that they can be built. And here you see, for the kind of telescopes that I was describing, the large, the medium, and the small telescopes, different prototypes that have been produced. This is a drawing, but those are pictures of those telescopes. So for the largest telescope, there is just one candidate, and this is the large-size telescope, the one that is already built in La Palma. For the mid-size telescopes, there is a little bit more variety. There is a design in which you have a single mirror and the camera in the focal plane, as is the case for the LST, but there is also a different concept which was developed by the Americans following the idea of Schwarzschild and Coudet. This is a double mirror telescope which provides wide field of view. It was proposed for optical telescopes, but was never built for optical telescopes, as far as I know, and has been built for a Cherenkov telescope, for a few of them, actually, because in the small-size telescopes, you also see that there are a single-mirror telescope, but two options with double mirrors. Okay, so those telescopes existed, exist now. So in 2015, we got the green light. We built those prototypes. They exist, and they have already seen first light. For instance, those are the three small-sized telescopes. The first one got first light already in 2016, so 1 year after we got the green light to start prototyping them. There is a prototype in Mount Etna of this double mirror, which has been used also to explore the inner part of Mount Etna, just looking for muons that are traversing the volcano. Well, this is a single mirror telescope. It has been tested at the mechanical level, but not the camera, because it's been produced with silicon PMs in a new configuration. This is the mid-size telescope. The prototype exists since 2016. I cannot show the results of the first light, because actually there are two camera candidates for this telescope, and there are not yet results that can be shown, but it is well understood how to build it. And this is the other mid-size telescope, the one I'm describing, this is Schwarzschild-Coudet configuration. It got first light just a few months ago, in January this year. And last but not least, as you will see, because it's very important for us, for the Spanish community, the large-size telescope. What you see here is the design, the drawing. Let me tell you that for us, especially for me, I'm a particle physicist. For me, fundamental physics is one of the strongest motivations. Having a direct handle on the large-size telescopes is very important, because those are the telescopes that allow us to go for the lowest energy, so below 200 GeV, so to overlap with Fermi, and then study transient phenomena like gamma ray burst, like pulsars, in a domain in which we have enough statistics to try to understand what's going on with the sources, and also AGNs and dark matter. So it is very important getting to the lowest threshold to address these scientific issues. There should be 4 of these telescopes in the south and 4 in the north, and I will explain the situation. As I said, this telescope already exists in La Palma and is in commissioning phase. Let me tell you now a little bit more of detail about the sites. The site in the north is in the Roque de los Muchachos. I will come a little bit later to some more numbers on the situation. And in the south, as I said, is Paranal in Chile. In the north, the distribution adopts to the ground. I'm convinced that many of you have been already at the Roque de los Muchachos Observatory. You know that it's not a flat patch of land of 1 square kilometer, so you have to adapt to all this geometry, and that was done. In Chile, this is in the middle of the desert. There is no problem. You can basically take the simplest geometry and that works for the configuration. Well, the northern site was already agreed with IEC end of 2016, and as I said, there should be 4 large telescopes and 15 mid-sized telescopes, mid-sized telescopes meaning 12 meters and large-sized telescopes meaning 23 meters. And concerning, that's important. Here you see the prototype that I was showing before in a drawing already built, but you see that there are two telescopes in the foreground. Those are the two magic telescopes. They are just nearby. And an obvious question is, wouldn't you be able to operate them as an array as well? I mentioned that the two magic telescopes have as a problem the fact that the sweet spot is relatively small. That reduces a little bit the sensitivity, but if you have three, then you are in much better conditions. And, indeed, this has been already agreed, and there is a memorandum of understanding between the MAGIC collaboration and the CTA LST collaboration to operate these telescopes together. And with this operation, as I mentioned at the beginning, this is going to be the most powerful Cherenkov observatory in the world until the rest of CTA is built. So this is going to happen in a few months from now because we are in the last phase of the commissioning of LST1. Then concerning CTA South, as I mentioned, it is going to be built in the desert. Actually, is in the Paranal site of ESO, near a set of existing VLT and future or in construction telescopes, ELT. And for this side, the agreement took a little bit longer. Some people was even nervous about whether the CTA South Observatory was going to be built or not, because the negotiations were really difficult. But finally, end of past year, the agreement was signed with ESO and with Chile. That is what complicated the things, that Chile also wanted to sign. By the way, after this signature, ESO became a partner of the CTA project. This was signed 3 weeks ago in Garching, in the ESO headquarters. So now CTA is also part of the ESO program. Okay, I mentioned at the beginning that we have two sites, but we also have decided already where the headquarters are going to be. This is the picture of the headquarters building. This is in Bologna, in a enough area in Bologna, and that's where the data centers or the science data management center is going to be located. That's in Berlin, Zeuthen. So all the elements are there to have CTA built. Then what are the plans? Well, those are the phases that as of today are planned. There was a pre-construction phase, which this is the information you find in the web page of CTA is a little bit outdated because we are not anymore in the pre-construction phase. The pre-production phase starts in 2019, and this is where we are now, because in the pre-production phase you have the first pre-production telescope, and this is exactly what has happened. We have the LST1 in the rocket, so we are already moving from this phase to this phase. And that means that, we should finish this pre-production phase by 2021, and then the full production phase, so the production should start full steam, and is expected to end in 2025. So that's the date for having the full observatory in operation. One of the things that has delayed the whole thing is the legal framework to establish these observatories. And finally, there is an agreement of using what is called an ERIC, European Research Infrastructure Consortium. And it is already decided that this ERIC will be established in 2020. So from 2020 on, officially, CTA will be in production of the observatories. Okay, very briefly, about CTA Spain. Well, CTA Spain Consortium was created back in 2006, so when the whole project was born, we were there from the very beginning. And nowadays there are 12 groups with about 100 people, I think it's more like 120 people at present involved. Here you see different colors for the institutes. Green stands for institutes which are focused on astrophysics. Typically, they get funds from the astronomy and astrophysics program. Here you see institutes in blue. By the way, here is your institute with Ivan as the leader of the project in this institute. In blue, you see institutes which are more focused to fundamental physics and therefore ask for funding to the FFP program, which is physics, fundamental physics and particles program. And even you have groups in red, which are groups interested in radiation physics and applied electronics, and a group in brown, which is PIC, related to computing. All these groups act as a consortium in which I have had the honor since from the very beginning to be the coordinator. And which kind of things, okay, good, yes. Which kind of things did we produce, or how have we get involved in CTA? Well, as I mentioned, our focus from the beginning has been the large size telescope. For two reasons. First, because the Spanish groups have been involved in MAGIC, and MAGIC are large-size telescopes. You see that the large-size telescopes look very much like the MAGIC design, so we had already the technical knowledge and expertise on building those telescopes. Second, because those are the main telescopes for the Northern Observatory, because the Northern Observatory is focused to extragalactic physics, as I said, and the key telescopes for that are the large-size telescopes. So if we want to have a good participation in the Northern Observatory, this is the right telescope to participate. Well, in this telescope, Spaniards have designed the mechanics for the azimuth movement. They have designed very key elements of the camera, the mechanics, the trigger, control, auxiliary systems, assembly, characterization. The camera of the telescope that is now at La Palma was built initially at CIEMAT in Madrid, then it was assembled and integrated with all the elements in Barcelona, in my institute, and then was sent to La Palma and started working from day one. So those are the key technological developments that in which Spaniards have contributed, but as I will show, we have also participated very intensively in the physics prospects, in the simulations, data management, where this institute is actively participating, and in the data center for the future. This building that I describe in Berlin is the Science Data Management Center, but it's not the data center. The data center will be distributed, and we hope one of the data centers will be in Spain, hopefully in PIC, in Barcelona. Of course, we have participated very intensively in site studies to demonstrate that La Palma is a good site for CTA, and in other elements that are described here. We have had key roles in the collaboration. I have been the co-spokesperson of the consortium since the beginning until 5 years ago. But we have had also the physics coordinator, data model coordinator, chair of the speakers and publication office. In red means positions that we don't have anymore. In blue, coordinator positions that we have at present. We have the current physics coordinator, is a Spaniard. She's from ICE in Barcelona. And the software and Monte Carlo coordinator, he's a Spaniard as well, he's from my institute. And in the LST project, which as I already mentioned is central for us, I'm the chair of the steering committee. We have the deputy PI of the project from CIEMAT, the LST system engineer from my institute, and the LST camp coordinator as well. And those are the technical developments that I described before. So I want to convince you that Spain is playing an important role inside CTA since the dawn of the project. This is about the community, but the community is not the whole thing. You need the support of the funding agency. And I think is interesting for you to understand how things happen. The community was very active, and Kit played, I would say, a key role in convincing our authorities to make a large investment. But It was also due to the fact that, as I explained, this project was identified already many years ago as an important project and was included in lists like the ESFRI list. Our authorities quickly realized that there are very few truly large worldwide research infrastructures which had real chances of being in Spain, and this was one of them. That gave already support to this project by the ministry in the programs that I was describing before, FFP, also AIA, and so on. And then Spain decided to sign, together with 12 more countries, the declaration of intent for the pre-construction already back in 2012. And two representatives were appointed to the council, Inma Figueroa from the ministry and Rafa Rebolo as director of IC, because the third component, which was extremely important, is that IC also got very interested and got committed. Was able to convince the Canaries authorities to give full support to the project and provide co-funding for the funds that the ministry decided to put on the table, which altogether is something like 40 million euros. Remember that the total cost that I was showing there for CTA was 300 million. So that's really an important contribution. These 40 million euros have 85% feather for the Canary Islands and 15% co-funding provided by the Canadian government. So with all this, let me tell you that we had a success story, and it's the fact that we really were able to get CTA North at the Roque de los Muchachos. This was not obvious. The competition was really very, very difficult, was fierce. We were competing with Arizona, we were competing with Mexico, with India at some point, so it was really very difficult. But we managed to coordinate three legs of the project in a very solid, stable table. CTA was provided the scientific and technological community, IC the hosting institution and the Feather Funds manager, and Mineco finally, is the host country, and as you could see, is an important CTA contributor. So after countless blood, sweat and tears, we got it. And the second, success history is that now we have LST1 in the Roque. LST1 is actually the most crucial milestone for the whole CTA project. Is the has been the anchor, saying, well, yes, we are here. Yes, CTA is going ahead because it's the first CTA telescope. We had the first stone ceremony back in October 2015 and the inauguration on October 2018, so past year. You don't need 3 years to build this telescope. In 1 year, you are able to do it. We had here some problems with the town halls of the villages to which the observatory belongs, but this will not happen in the future, we have been told. So now things should go rather smooth. In principle, this is a prototype telescope, but the cost of the telescope is 10 million euros. So, as I said, LST1 is de facto the first CTA telescope. And as I explained, the Spaniards there have played a key role. This is a picture of the moment of the first stone ceremony, October in 2015. Here I was giving some speech. And let me just tell you that this guy here is Takaki Kajita. He's a Nobel Prize. He got the Nobel Prize just a couple of days before coming to this ceremony. And, all of us were really impressed that he decided to come to La Palma for this ceremony when he was really getting phone calls all the time because he just got the Nobel Prize a couple of days before. But he came here because he was so impressed by the physics program that was explained to him by our Japanese colleagues that he made some statement in the press, which at the beginning I thought, my God, you don't say these kind of things, come on. But, he said, this Nobel Prize for Physics is putting in Spain the first stone for a future Nobel. We don't know what will come out of CTA, but there is no Nobel Prize yet given to gamma ray astronomy. And maybe CTA will be able to observe things that will be worth a Nobel Prize for this window of observation. Okay, here what you see is the outcome of this excitation by Takaki Kajita. Many of us went then to Tokyo and there was an agreement signed between Japan and our ministry. Here you have the former Secretary of State for Research. She played a key role supporting CTA to be in the present situation, so we are really grateful to her. But this agreement guaranteed that the four LSTs are funded to be built in the Northern Observatory. And, well, then we had the inauguration of the first one, and we will not make big inaugurations for the coming three ones because they will come very soon. We are already building all the elements to have these four telescopes by the end of 2021. This telescope is a prototype, and as I already mentioned, we already detected first light, and this, believe me, this is a very nice gamma ray event, very clean, with an electromagnetic shower here, which is escaping because it's from a very energetic particle and a little bit out of axis. Okay, just the last point, very briefly. CTA will be an observatory, and that's an important message I want to convey to you. An observatory worth for what? I mean, what is the goal of CTA? If you go to the observatory page, that's the motto of CTA, exploring the universe at the highest energies. And indeed, those are the research topics that have been identified. The goals of CTA are improving our knowledge on cosmic rays, so finding the sites of acceleration in our galaxy and beyond, the search for pevatrons for the origin of cosmic rays that we don't know up to this moment, after over 100 years of search, and the cosmic ray interactions with galaxies and clusters. But also, of course, probing extreme environments like relativistic jets and winds in the vicinity of neutron stars and black holes. Also probing the intergalactic medium, so the intergalactic magnetic fields and the background radiation fields that absorb the gammas when they travel to us at those energies. Exploring physics frontiers like indirect dark matter searches in the form of WIMPs or axions. Beyond the bounds that CERN is putting with the Large Hadron Collider, and also testing the invariance of the speed of light and trying to see whether the gravity really has a kind of quantum behavior that we can spot. And last but not least, and this is proved by the recent results of MAGIC with IceCube, the connection with cosmic rays, with neutrinos, and with gravitational waves, which are also messengers from the extreme universe, which is exactly what you observe with these very high-energy gamma rays. Why CTA will be able to do a leap on that? This was very well summarized by Jim Hinton, who is still the CTAO project scientist, although very likely soon will be a Spaniard. He's leaving the position, and there is a excellent candidate from Spain to take this position. Well, first, CTA will be able to go down up to energies of 20 GeV. This is not the case with the current generation. Our threshold now is more like 40 GeV. And this 20 GeV difference really makes a difference when you think, for instance, in dark matter, in cosmology, and other applications like that. Second, CTA will have a very rapid slewing, 20 seconds, and precisely these days, today, engineers from IFAE are at La Palma testing the highest speed of repositioning of this prototype that I was showing you. And while I was already here, I checked my email a few hours ago, and they said, yes, we got it. We are below 20 seconds for any repositioning in the sky. Well, the energy resolution with so many images will reach 10%, so you get already sensitivity to observe lines in this very high energy domain, and features in the spectra that may identify, for instance, dark matter or any other component which may be unexpected in those spectrum. Well, the sensitivity and the collection area, as was already the target, should be 10 times larger. That affects all the topics that we have been discussing. The field of view will be in a single pointing, already 8 degrees, which doubles the current field of view of the existing telescopes. So you can do surveys also with the technique I explained before, and therefore also study extended objects, which was not possible so far. The angular resolution should reach few arc minutes, and therefore you can study the morphology of these accelerators, of these cosmic accelerators, in an unprecedented manner, and therefore understand what's going on there at the highest energies. And since we use such a large area, we should, as I already explained, observe pevatrons if they exist. So we should reach an energy of 300 TeV, which so far hasn't been observed with the current generation. Everything that I explain here, you can find in two articles that I sent to some of you that asked me for some literature to prepare this meeting. There was a first book that was published in 2013. That was before we started building the telescopes, but when we were really having a clear concept of how things should go, and we were thinking how this concept should materialize in telescopes. So what you find in this book is how do you build from the concept of what you want such an infrastructure. Yeah? I was corresponding author for this publication. And then you have a much more recent publication. This is actually from December past year. It's a book in World Scientific. This is the identification, over 200 pages, which is called Science with the Cherenkov Telescope Array. So if you want to understand really what the ideas have already been explored about what you can do with CTA, please have a look to this book. Furthermore, the CTA Observatory has organized what they call the first science symposium. This is open to the whole scientific community in particle physics and in astrophysics. This is going to happen in Bologna from the 6th to the 9th of May, so a couple of months from now. And the motto is, again, exploring the high-energy universe with CTA and then trying to understand what can you get from such an infrastructure beyond what people have been thinking. Okay, just a couple more of slides. I mentioned at the beginning that CTA will be an observatory. What is the concept of an observatory in our view? Well, this is time, this is observation time, and then as time goes on, we will start deploying the observatory and it will reach completion at some moment. While we are trying to reach completion, basically what you get here is 100% of the time for the consortium that is building the instruments. And as we are approaching full deployment, this consortium time will reduce and then open time will start rising. Then open time will be open to proposals, and the exact format is not yet decided. It will be casted in stone when the ERIC is created. But the idea is that basically open time will be used by scientists of the party countries, although this is still in discussion on how to implement it. Then let me talk a little bit about the consortium time. So if you are going to get open time, why do you need to get involved in building the telescopes or being part of the consortium? Well, because the consortium will have this consortium time, especially at the beginning, but also at the end, to do key science programs. And these key science programs you see here cover the most of the elements I was describing already. The elements that we know should be there and therefore we should not miss. So galactic center, pevatrons, Large Magellanic Cloud Survey, AGNs, galaxy clusters, transients, and so on. This does not mean that this is all you can do with this infrastructure. Of course, you may have additional ideas that nobody thought, and this is what we expect from this open time for observers in general. But if you join the consortium, as this institute has done, you will be able to look at all this already with the data that will come in a few months from now, and therefore, well, make discoveries as well as the gravitational wave, for instance, in engineering runs. So I think one has to be in the consortium and participate in the construction. So let me now go to my summary and outlook. This is exactly, this is supposed to be a copy of what I shown in the first slide, so I don't need to read it again. But let me add since CTA shall be an open observatory, and moreover, Spain has a host premium time, a guaranteed time of 10%, which also can be used in CTA South, all of you are invited to make out of it a great scientific discovery machine in a few years from now. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Manel. That's a very interesting talk. So that's time for questions, please.
Thanks for the talk. I wanted to know about this multi-messenger part. Are there any coordinations with LIGO or with IceCube to be able to do that, or how does it work?
But for the current generation of instruments, it exists. I mentioned that one of the science papers that you could see in the list was the discovery of an AGN related to a neutrino that was detected by IceCube. I think that went to a press release in which IceCube people wanted to stress that this may be the starting of neutrino astronomy. That was possible because there is a written agreement between MAGIC and IceCube, between IceCube and HES, between IceCube and Veritas, in which we receive triggers. So every time there is a neutrino alert that fulfills conditions that make it worth follow-up by Cherenkov telescopes, we get an alert, and then we just move the telescopes and look in that direction. The same happens with gamma ray bursts, and the same happens with gravitational waves. So, yes, this is happening already. And, of course, it will be much, much more important with CTA because one of the reasons why, for instance, we have missed already several gamma ray bursts and probably more neutrino alerts is because we don't have the energy coverage necessary to catch those events. So we need to go lower in threshold because those events have been observed in Fermi. Second, because even with energy coverage, you need to have the area which guarantees that you have enough flux to have the statistics to claim that there is a discovery and so on. And that will be provided by CTA.
Can I have another question? I wanted to know if there are observations of Cherenkov light pulses from pulsars.
Yes. Pulsars is one subject in which it has taken a long time for the current generation of Cherenkov telescopes to say something. But once we understood how to use properly the telescope, now we have a few pulsars detected. The first observation came from MAGIC, that was an article in Science. We observed the Crab Nebula pulsar, and was unexpected because if you would just extrapolate the Fermi spectrum, no signal should have been seen. Then we had a lot of data in the Crab, because the Crab is almost a calibration source in very high energy gamma ray astronomy. It's a very intense source, which is steady, at least in our range of energy. But we were not looking at the data in the right way to detect the pulsar. Then once we learned that, MAGIC detected Crab, HES detected Vela, and now I think I can say we detect the Geminga as well. So we are opening the scope in the number of pulsars that are detected in this range. CTA will be able to detect not just three, but really a sizable number of pulsars.
Thank you. Nice talk, and also for the overview on the kind of science we can approach with CTA. And I would like if you can give a few remarks about the project behind the detection of dark matter, which is the main ideas behind this project.
Okay, well, dark matter nowadays is a subject in which people start being nervous because you know that at LHC the most plausible candidates for dark matter haven't been found. I mean, LHC in this sense had a big success, which was the detection of the Higgs, and a big failure, so to say, and is the fact that nothing else has been detected, nothing new. People was expecting to observe, say, supersymmetric particles, which could be good candidates for dark matter. With Cherenkov telescopes, you can detect particles which CERN will not be able to produce, so supersymmetric particles of higher energies than the ones you get in accelerators like LHC. But you can also, those are WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles, but you can also explore alternative candidates like axions. Axions and axion-like particles. Axions are particles very difficult to detect in general because the space parameter in which you should look for them is very wide and is very difficult to cover such a large space parameter with few experiments. So you have to produce many experiments to cover different patches of this space parameter. But they have a feature which makes them, very handy for us. And the feature is that axion-like particles convert to gammas. And that means that regardless on the space parameter, well, not regardless, but relatively independent of the space parameter in which you try to find these particles as candidates for dark matter, for instance, what happens is that they would convert, I mean, they would appear in conversions of distant cosmological gammas that are emitted by AGN and is traveling to us. And that would reflect in the fact that you would observe less absorption than what you would expect for this range of energies. There are bounds that have been placed already. Those bounds are competitive with the bounds you get from specific experiments. And in the case of CTA, the precision you can get in the determination of the extragalactic background light spectrum, so the absorption of the gammas for very distant sources, will allow still to increase very much the space parameter. Well, what I'm explaining is, I don't have, unfortunately, slides that I can show you, but certainly I recommend you to go to this second book that I mentioned here, because there detailed simulations have been performed about what may you expect from CTA.
Thanks, Manel, for your talk. I have a question about the distribution of the telescopes within the site, on site. I mean, has it been studied which is the best configuration of the LSTs, MSTs, and SSTs in the south in order to produce the science you're looking for?
And I'm proud to say that the person that has led these simulations is from my institute. Is the current software and Monte Carlo coordinator is Abelardo Moralejo. He's a member from IFAE. And, those are difficult optimizations because you have many telescopes, you have many possibilities, many distributions. But yes, this has been performed, and what you see here is the optimal configuration concerning the number of flavors of telescopes and also the space distribution on ground of those telescopes. No. For the LSTs, yes, because the minimal number of LSTs to avoid this effect that we have in magic of the sweet spot being too small is 4. So 4 LSTs is untouchable. Of course, you would like to have more than 4, but each LST is 10 million euros. So when you optimize with a constraint, which is how much money you have, yeah? If you have infinite money, there is no need for optimization. You put infinite number of telescopes, and that's the ideal detector. So for the LSTs, north and south is symmetric. It's for LSTs because it's the minimum number that guarantees the science that you can do with the LSTs. For the MSTs, there are just 15 in the north, and there are 25 in the south. And that is because the optimization also takes into account what you expect a scientific output. Yeah. I mean, if you want to put more emphasis in one thing or another thing, that changes the number of telescopes. Specifically in the north, the emphasis is in extragalactic science. And in extragalactic science, we know how the absorption will kill, so to say, the highest energies. And therefore, you optimize already having this in mind. And that means that it would be a waste putting 25 MSTs because, well, you don't gain so much by investing so much money in those telescopes because you are not going to get gammas justifying these telescopes. In the south, it's different. In the south, you also target galactic physics. You have the galactic center, a big fraction of the galactic plane. There, the absorption is negligible. And there, really, it pays off also putting these small-sized telescopes, which occupy these 10 square kilometers, because then you have such a large area that you can catch pevatrons. I mean, you can catch sources that emit at the highest energies that we may imagine to justify the cosmic rays.
Okay. Thank you very much again for the nice talk. I have a question. You have already mentioned about the first detection of a GRB with a Cherenkov telescope. By MAGIC. So I was wondering, because this is a result that has been looked for many years. So what was really special in this case? Was it the source? Was it the procedure for observation? And if you could comment on the prospects for CTA for such kind of observations?
Let me tell you that the information about this gamma ray burst is under embargo. So yes, I have a limited amount of information I can convey. And actually, it's very interesting because I was discussing with a candidate for a Nobel Prize not long ago in time, and he told me, okay, this may be the most important discovery in the field in the last 10 years, the first thing that he said. And the second thing he said is, I cannot understand how a collaboration of almost 200 people is so silent. I get no information about that. This is a very special gamma ray burst. That is the only thing that I can tell you. So I'm not sure whether we can extrapolate it for CTA, saying, well, what CTA will observe are gamma ray bursts like this one. No, this one is really, wow, wow.
Next invitation.
We are almost ready to, well, we are finishing two papers for science, no, for Nature, and preparing three more papers for science, just with this gamma ray burst. So it's a very special beast. Yesterday, we had the meeting for these two first papers, so the discovery paper and a multi-wavelength paper that we are preparing with seven more observatories. And the draft is already circulating. The first one should be ready in a couple of weeks. The second one will have to circulate also in the other collaborations. It will take a little bit longer. And in parallel, we are producing three more papers with the implications in Lorentz invariance violation, axions, whatever. Because, well, looks interesting. No, CTA is not yet at this level of organization. LST1, you know, the hope of many of us was that since with MAGIC we were really unable to catch any gamma ray burst, although we tried hard for many years, the hope was, okay, now we'll have LST1, the first target that we are going to give priority for this system of three telescopes should be gamma ray burst, because with these three telescopes, I mean, you really increase I would say, impressive manner the sensitivity and the performance just by putting one more large-size telescope to the MAGIC telescopes. But, well, suddenly the two MAGIC telescopes alone got this gamma ray burst. So, okay, now it is not so clear what do you gain with LST1. But LST1, nowadays, is property of the LST collaboration. So the data that we produce with this telescope is not for the whole CTA, it's for the LST project team. 50% almost Spaniards, so it's our telescope. And if anything can be seen with this telescope, any discovery is our discovery. Once it is delivered to the observatory and accepted by the observatory in, say, 1 year from now, then it will be property of the observatory and the consortium.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice talk. I have a question about the sensitivity curve. Why the small size telescope have a higher sensitivity at the highest energies?
Well, it's just a matter of idea. I mean, the the flux from all cosmic sources follows a power law with an index which is typically between 2 and 3. So it is falling very steeply. That means that when you try to reach pevatrons, so 300 petaelectron balls, 500, you run out of gammas because you need a very large area to catch those gammas. And the small size telescopes, what they do is you invest little money because each small size telescope costs, I don't know, 200 kilo euros, something like that, compared to the 10 million euros of the large size telescope. And then you produce many of them. 70 is the optimal number that we have computed. And then you put them in a very large area extending 10 square kilometers. That is what gives the sensitivity to the highest energies.
Is there any other question? Or if not, I'd just like to congratulate you for the very, really nice talk and for the whole workers behind. So let's thank Manel again. And thanks for listening.